Real-time analytics market is experiencing significant growth. Estimates indicate that the market is projected to expand from $27.6 billion today to $147.5 billion by 2031. I'm Paul Nashawaty, the practice lead and principal analyst for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research, and I'm joined today by Kishore to discuss insights on real-time analytics. Kishore, welcome, and would you like to introduce yourself?
Hey, Paul, thank you so much for having me on the show. It's a pleasure being here. I'm Kishore Gopalakrishna. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Startree. And prior to that, I created Apache Pinot and a lot of other distributed systems projects back at LinkedIn.
Great to have you on the show. It's really an exciting time because a lot is happening with application development. We're seeing that there's a lot of AI agents that are coming into play, and these new applications are powered by real-time insights and analytics. With these real-time analytics, they really transform how to infuse the applications with these insights. I'm really curious, based on our conversations and our briefings that we had, that's why I wanted you on the show. Can you talk a little bit about some of the new advancements that Startree has been doing, because it's really relevant to this topic?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think one of the key things, even before AI and AI agents came into picture, we have been on this journey to kind of truly democratize data, right? When I say that, it's really taking data to people beyond your internal users within the company. So this is something that we started back at LinkedIn, where you see any number on LinkedIn, it's all being powered by Apache Pinot technology. So what this let humans do is, instead of making a call and then trying to get data from someone and making a decision, you have the data to yourself, and all the millions and billions of users of LinkedIn are making decisions, right? And another example is like the Uber Eats, where you see how long it takes for someone to serve an order. That is also a real-time analytics data. So if you kind of step back and look at it, this journey of making providing data to users to make decisions has been something that we started a long time ago, right? And now agents are actually taking it to the next level, which is like, hey, now I have all these access to this data. How can I actually make decisions on top of that, right? And if you think about AI agents coming into picture, think about now Uber Eats. Imagine an agent having all the information of like, hey, what kind of things do you prefer? What are your constraints? Like, you want like something ordered immediately, you're ordering during which time of the day, what do you like? And imagine something actually making the decision for you, instead of you going and having to scroll all these things and you have all these different constraints, you're in this different place. I think that's the world that we are living in. And I think what Startree is really into is being able to provide access to this data, right? And we have been in this business, we have been providing access to this data to the users, but now it's like, you can take it to one step further, which is like, hey, humans don't have to look at this data and make a decision. Can I have a personalized agent that actually understands my requirements, my customizations that I generally do, and then it does the job for me? It definitely saves a lot of time. And I'm sure a lot of people would love to have some AI agent like this, which does the food ordering for you.
Well, absolutely. And when I think about what you're talking about, you know, I look at the application developers' productivity challenges, right? We see that in our research that most developers spending about 24% of their time developing applications, and the rest of their time is spent on just kind of ancillary things. But unlike those traditional applications, these AI agents, they take action on the data, right? So like, it's not just about you know, serving up an application, serving up the data back, but it's actually about actionable insights to what's happening. Is that where you're coming from with the dialogue?
Yeah, exactly, right? I think all these, if I look at the whole stack, it's really about analyzing, visualizing, and then acting. And that last part of acting is actually very crucial, because if you just analyze the data and you visualize, and if you're not acting on it, you're not really leveraging the value that you're getting from the data. So I think AI agents actually make it a lot more easier for you to take it to the next level in terms of not just making the decisions for you, but also acting on it, right? So I mean, imagine not stopping at saying that, hey, this is what you should order, but clicking on the app and then taking it all the way and say like, okay, I've already placed the order, and it constantly provides you the update as well. So it's definitely, the possibilities are endless here in terms of what can be done with the agentic world. And the best part is all these different things people talk about the master agent, which kind of talks to different agents, right? Because yeah, we will be part of that chain where we are providing the data, but then there are a lot of other things that needs to be done. But that's kind of where we fit in the whole stack, in terms of being able to allow agents to actually query this. And we have done a couple of things where we actually just ask questions in a natural language and we understand the schema. And imagine like Uber Eats as like a schema that says, okay, what is the order time? What is it start? What did the order? But instead of the user having to understand the schema, you just ask the question in the natural language and the agent automatically figures out what query needs to be run, what's the broker endpoint, and then gets the result, figures out what columns mean what in the results, and then takes the next set of actions. So I think these are all the things that are being possible today, and you get very little amount of work that needs to be done from an application developer.
You know, it almost sounds that like you're taking or going after that skill gap issue that you see with developers, where, you know, just a few years ago, you'd have to have a developer writing actual code to make things happen. Now you can really use that natural language to solve those complex solutions that you're trying to build out. That's an important factor here. I do want to shift a little bit and talk about, the real-time RAG and with the actionable insights, right? Mm-hmm. I think that this is a big focus for a lot of businesses looking to generate dynamic and up-to-date responses based on these data streams. How is that impacting the offering, and what does that mean for, you know, how do you see that moving forward?
That's a very important part of this, right? I mean, if you have the real-time RAG, which is basically in essence means that you're making decisions based on the latest and greatest data, right? I mean, if I just take the same example back, you don't want to pick a restaurant which was serving the order in like 15 minutes yesterday or day before yesterday. You want what is happening right now, because it might be taking an hour or two today versus what was happening yesterday. And that's one example. But now you think about expanding this into your financial world, where the stocks market is changing drastically every second, or even in terms of the crypto world and all these other places, right? So the value of data, is we all know, decreases exponentially as the time passes by. And real-time RAG is really about, hey, do I have access to this data so that my decisions are enriched by this additional information that I have that I didn't have at the time of generating my models. So it's a natural next step, because people are making decisions based on the models, but now the models also need to take into account the latest and greatest data and not the stale data, because your decisions are as good as the freshness of the data is, right?
Yeah, I really like your use case there that you talked about, like a restaurant, right? You know, I mean, if ingredients run out in the kitchen, you can make those changes real time. Yeah. Now, I guess what I, you know, this is something that's, you know, one, I would argue that RAG is as a whole is relatively a, you know, newer kind of concept. But then like when you start putting now real-time RAG, now it's changing so rapidly in the market. Like all the AI pieces are changing so rapidly. What do you feel like the adoption is? I know that there's a desired state where organizations would like to get there, but what do you think the current adoption is, and where do you think it's going within the next, say, 3 months or 3 years?
I think the adoption is already there. I think it is just a little bit more extension in terms of getting it into the AI world, right? Which is, if you think about Uber, for example, they have Uber Freight, and they actually completely gamified the system in terms of making sure that they track where the drivers are, where the route is. They can, in real time, reroute the trucks if there is a traffic issue, or are they on track? So all these things, I mean, Uber has actually built provided an article as well on, they're saving millions of dollars by actually providing a real-time visibility or monitoring on top of that. Now, right now, the state it is in is like there is an operator who is looking at all this data and then directing them to do XYZ based on the changes in the data. But now they're already getting into the next level in terms of, hey, how can I put AI on top of it? And then these models are actually using the real-time RAG as well as along with the models that they've already built. And it's making decisions on based on behalf of the drivers. So that's kind of already is already happening. And I think that's the way I think about it, Paul, in terms of the evolution is you had this world where everything was driven by reports, which would go like once a month or once a week or once a day to like having your information at the tip of your fingers where human is making a decision. And then we did have at some point machines making decisions, but you have to build the model, you have to train it, and then there was a lot of work that is involved. Now the next step is really on the AI agents making these decisions automatically for you because they are a lot better in terms of figuring out what features are important, what features are not important, right? I mean, that's really the difference if you go back to the machine learning world to the AI is like in machine learning, you need a data scientist, do all the training, figure out which features are important, which are not important, like build the model. But with AI, a lot of those things get automatically figured out. You don't have to really spoon feed that or like say, these are the things that are important.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, when I think about some of our conversations that we've had and, you know, and I think about how businesses are implementing that real-time benefits from improving the decision-making, they're also looking at operational efficiencies and customer satisfaction. And one of the examples that I did want to share, because I think it aligns nicely to this use case, is the Three Men Movers, the Texas-based moving company that integrated AI technology to monitor the driver behavior and optimize routing. They resulted in 4.5% reduction in accidents within the first 3 months and increased the detection accuracy by 91%. Really cool stuff, right? Yeah. That's a use case of how it's happening. So I think it's really, really interesting for the audience to understand that this is not just theoretical and academic. This is actually really happening in the world today, and it's happening really fast. And I would also say that it's a competitive advantage to have this on board in your organization.
Yeah, no, and that, I think that's a great point, right? The fact that this company in Texas is actually doing it, and it's not just restricted to the tech companies or like the real innovators and the leaders in the space. It is actually a testament of this is not just like a cutting, I mean, it is a cutting edge technology, but it's not really limited to companies with resources, but pretty much anyone can actually benefit from this changes that's happening in the AI world.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And then when we, you know, like one of the things that I do want to talk about, because I think it's important as well as part of this, you know, the changes that are happening is the shifts to real-time analytics and observability too, right? Mm-hmm. Observability is really going through a lot of changes within organizations, and real-time analytics is part of that modular architecture. Actually, what we're seeing in our research is there are 75% of our respondents in our research, recent study, show that they're using 6 to 15 different tools for observability, and they're not able to understand how to rationalize all the data that comes across it. So, you know, I'm curious what your thoughts are here on observability. This is definitely a topic that's near and dear to my heart, and actionable insights is key, you know, for running the business. We also see 54% of organizations are looking to move towards a more harmonized or a unified solution in 2025 alone. So that's interesting. So what are your thoughts?
No, I think I can probably talk about this for the next 1 hour or so, but let me try to keep it very, very simple. I think if you look at the evolution of the observability space, right, it's like started off with point solutions for a specific use case. I mean, you had right from the days of AppDynamics solving just the APM use cases, and then the Splunk solving the log use cases, and then other companies like Elastic trying to solve the logs and as well as the tracing and other use cases as well. So all the time, it has been an end-to-end solution. What that means is all the way from collecting the data to transporting the data to storing to visualizing to act to finally act on that has been like one single solution. But that's kind of the vertical solution that I've... But what's happening right now is that model is flipping. It kind of goes back to your point of with that existing model, you need like 50 plus solutions to actually solve your problem. But now people are standardizing horizontally. It's like, hey, can I have one agent model to actually collect all my data? So that's where like things like OpenTelemetry and Prometheus are becoming the standard. And then what is my transport layer? Can I have standardized on one? And finally on the storage and query as well as on the visualization. So that's kind of where we are coming in, where we are saying this is the horizontal storage and query layer that you can actually store your logs, your metrics, your events, all these things. And now you can build different applications on top of it. And that's the solves the other problem of you don't have silos. Now all these different applications can have access to all the data. And that allows you to make better decisions and kind of get away from this limitation that you have that, hey, I have this data in this system, but now I need to go to this other system to also make this decision. And then you have to work with all these different levels of APIs that are available versus just standardizing on a SQL layer and then being able to mix and match all this data and make the right decisions. So I think that's one part of just architectural simplification. And then you bring in, put AI on top of it, that makes it even more better that you don't have to worry about structuring the data as much as you did before. You can just pump in your logs as it is, and then there can be a lot of more sophisticated models that can understand, and you don't have to tie these things together. I mean, there is crazy world which is trying to tie every log from different applications using the trace ID, but maybe you can just dump all of them together and say like, hey, give me the log from all these different applications for this particular request ID that I actually send, and it can probably do a better job than you having to tie all these things while ingesting the data. So I think it is a super exciting time for us in terms of how we can actually completely disrupt this observability world and then come up with a much better cost-effective solution as well.
Yeah, and I think that what you're basically saying here, just and kind of then wrapping it up a little bit here, is there's a crawl, walk, run approach. You know, you're meeting the client where they are in their journey. There's a maturity that a lot of organizations are running into where they're trying to get to this end state of utilizing all sorts of aspects of observability, but don't have that that ability, that skill set, that mm-hmm. gap. Is there, they don't know how to do it yet. So they're trying to get there. So their learning needs to occur. And when that learning occurs, you're along the journey with them to provide that information. That's really important. I think it's a key area. You know, I know we just touched on a lot of stuff and there's a lot of information here. And I know it's just kind of really the beginning of the conversation, not the end, but unfortunately we are just wrapping up out of time here. Where would you advise the audience to go if they wanted to learn more about you?
Obviously there's a ton of information, and I think especially for real-time analytics, we do have a real-time analytics summit. So there are a lot of videos from the past few years where variety of our customers and our users of Apache Pinot and others have provided great talks. So you can definitely visit that. And then there are a lot of use cases as well on Startree.ai, where you can see companies like Stripe, DoorDash, and others on how they're actually leveraging the technology to solve the next set of challenges that are coming up. So highly encourage the users to check them out. And I think there is a lot of learning there.
Well, thank you, Kishore. Thank you for your time and your insights. This has been great. I also want to share with the audience, we have a lot of new research coming out throughout 2025, specifically in that day two or the observability space. We have a lot of refresh in our insights and the research there. We'll have to share that with you. So feel free to reach out for that information as well. But thank you again for your time today, and thank you for the audience for watching our session, and have a great day.
Thank you, Paul. It was great being on the show.